In 1898, two African lions terrorized workers of the Uganda Railroad, a project put forward by the British government in the hope of moving people inland into Africa. These man-eating lions stalked, killed, and devoured workers, and were known in the local dialect by the names the Ghost and the Darkness. They were brazen and ferocious. It was eventually concluded that one of the lions had eaten 11 humans and another 24 before they were stopped. Before we read our text this morning, I want us to pause and trace backward through time and try to imagine this kind of setting without these strong cement walls around us, without the benefit of guns and animal control people and such things like zoos with bars and so forth. I want to try to imagine the vulnerability that a human being would feel facing ferocious, man-eating, man-devouring lions. I want us to try to remember that for a moment. Let's try to imagine what it would be like to come face to face with an animal much stronger, much faster, with an appetite that is driven by an instinct to slaughter and devour. Imagine being face to face with a man-eating lion. Imagine that. Let's try to sink into that experience for a moment. Imagine hearing or watching or knowing of people that were thrown into a den of lions with the intended purpose that they would be eaten. If we can sort of turn off our modern minds, our modern mentality, and get into the raw, terrifying vulnerability of that, I think we're prepared to read Daniel chapter 6. Let's read the first half of the chapter together, and then we'll comment on it a bit, and then we'll look at the second half. It pleased Darius to set over the kingdom 120 satraps to be throughout the whole kingdom, and over them three high officials, of whom Daniel was one, to whom these satraps should give account so that the king might suffer no loss. Then this Daniel became distinguished above all the other high officials and satraps because an excellent spirit was in him. And the king planned to set him over the whole kingdom. Then the high officials and the satraps sought to find ground for a complaint against Daniel with regard to the kingdom. But they could find no ground for complaint or any fault because he was faithful, and no error or fault was found in him. Then these men said, "We shall not find any ground for complaint against this Daniel unless we find it in connection with the law of his God." Then these high officials and satraps came by agreement to the king and said to him, "O King Darius, live forever. All the high officials of the kingdom, the prefects and the satraps and the counselors and the governors are agreed that the king should establish an ordinance and enforce an injunction that whoever makes petition to any god or man for 30 days, except to you, O king, shall be cast into the den of lions. Now, O king, establish the injunction and sign the document so that it cannot be changed according to the law of the Medes and the Persians, which cannot be revoked." Therefore, King Darius signed the document and injunction, and when Daniel knew that the document had been signed, he went to his house where he had windows in his upper chamber open toward Jerusalem. He got down on his knees three times a day and prayed and gave thanks before his God, as he had done previously. Then these men came by agreement and found Daniel making petition and plea before his God. And then they came near and said before the king concerning the injunction, "O king, did you not sign an injunction that anyone who makes petition to any god or man within 30 days, except to you, O king, shall be cast into the den of lions?" And the king answered and said, "The thing stands fast, according to the law of the Medes and Persians, which cannot be revoked." Then they answered and said before the king, "Daniel, who is one of the exiles from Judah, pays no attention to you, O king, for the injunction you have signed, but makes his petition three times a day. Then the king, when he heard these words, was much distressed and set his mind to deliver Daniel, and he labored till the sun went down to rescue him. And then these men came by agreement to the king and said to the king, "Know, O king, that it is a law of the Medes and Persians that no injunction or ordinance that the king establishes can be changed." Then the king commanded, and Daniel was brought and cast into the den of lions. The king declared to Daniel, "May your God, whom you serve continually, deliver you." And a stone was brought and laid on the mouth of the den, and the king sealed it with his own signet and with the signet of his lords, that nothing might be changed concerning Daniel. And then the king went to his palace and spent the night fasting. No diversions were brought to him, and sleep fled from him. I'm going to caption this first half of the chapter, "The Roaring Lions." The roaring lions. The initial roar of the lions in this passage is not the physical lions in the den. It's these counselors who are determined to destroy Daniel. Daniel, as we know, we've studied this book, is an exile from Judah, although this is Daniel in advanced age. So he has served first the Babylonian emperor, and then when Babylon was toppled by the Medo-Persian Empire, he now serves the Persian ruler Darius. It says at the beginning of this chapter that Darius set up governors to rule. This was a vast empire, governors called satraps, to rule the kingdom, and over them, three primary officials to govern the kingdom. And then it says that Daniel was so distinguished because of his faithfulness and his skill and excellence, the spirit that is in him, that he's going to be promoted above even those three ruling supervisors, so that he will literally be over the entire kingdom, apparently second in command to Darius himself. So Daniel's promotion is the first thing we notice. Now, I've mentioned before, we study the book of Daniel, as true in most Old Testament, the main point is not Daniel as an example. The main point is what God is going to do with Daniel. That's the main point. However, there are some things we can learn from Daniel's experience here. It is possible to serve a secular, non-Christian government or society faithfully and with excellence, as Daniel does here. It is possible to do that without compromising, or as long as you don't compromise, your Christian faith. It's something meaningful that Daniel is an example of a faithful civic, we might say, civic servant, so much so that he's promoted and is going to be put in charge of the entire kingdom. This ancient, he was likely at this point 80 or so years old, has been given an incredible capacity and power over this kingdom. The exile from Judah has been promoted through his faithfulness and the favor of his God to rule over the Medo-Persian Empire of the ancient world on behalf of Darius. Incredible. Incredible promotion, but that promotion leads to jealousy. Apparently motivated by jealousy, they're other satraps and the three officials and the other governors don't want this exile given this kind of power. I think you can sense a little bit of the mockery when they go all the way back to Daniel's youth, when they talk about Darius and they remind him, look, this is an exile. This isn't some Babylonian official that you just transferred into your government. This is an exile. He was a prisoner from a conquered nation. Let's remember who this is, they tell him. So they begin scheming. But you want to notice in that next paragraph that they can find no fault against him as it relates to the kingdom. Now, again, not the main point, but a helpful application. Of who could it be said that they could find no fault against any of us? That they scour, this is the original, search for the skeleton in the closet committee. Can we find something, surely something, some small bribe that he took, some injustice that he overlooked with all of his responsibilities? Surely he neglected some responsibilities. Surely he prioritized or he favored a friend in some way, somehow, surely something. And these men can find nothing against him. May that be said of us. That God can so look down on us, most importantly, but secondarily, that our neighbors and our friends and our coworkers and those that receive our payments and so forth could say, I couldn't find any, if we're going to find anything against them, it's going to have to be as it relates to their following of their God. May that be said of us. That's what's said of Daniel. Daniel's integrity comes through here. But then we come to Daniel's enemies. They are not deterred. So they establish a trap. They know that the one thing they have on Daniel is, in comparison to their religious flexibility, he is inflexible. They know they have that on him. So if we can set up a contrast between Darius and the kingdom and his God, we'll have him. Because we know for sure that Daniel will choose to follow God. Now, I think in their trap, there is, in a sense, a commendation of Daniel, in effect. Isn't it marvelous that they are confident this trap will work? Why? Well, because Daniel has proven that his confidence and his hope and his priority is in the Lord. They don't have any doubt, it seems, that this trap will work because, you know, Daniel, he's always praying. He loves God more than anything. He loves God more than his own life. That's what's going to happen. He'll read this. I know what's going to happen. This is a way, certainly, we can get rid of Daniel. May every Christian have the same ambition. That it could be said of us, oh, if we force them, they'll choose God. I mean, you can imagine the argument from somebody that doesn't know Daniel as well in that committee. I don't think so, guys. Like, have you seen the den of lions? It's fairly ferocious. Not a good way to go. One bite at a time, okay? I mean, this is not, you know, I bet you he'll hide. I don't think he'll find a way. He'll worship God in secret. We're not going to catch him. He's not going to keep doing the same routine. I don't think he's going to. Who would follow their God into the den of lions? And then those who know him well say, oh, trust me, Daniel would. I mean, he had friends, and his friends were going to go into the furnace, and they wouldn't even bow before the idol, and Daniel's the same way. What a commendation of a person whose priority is fixed, so fixed on the Lord that those around him can guarantee he'll fall for this. He'll do this. This is a surefire way to get him in that den, get rid of him. Find a way to make him choose between God and the kingdom. He'll choose God, even if it means a den of lions. May that be said of us. May that be said of you. May that be said of you by your coworkers. May it be said of me by my neighbors. May it be said of me by my family members. Look, if it comes down to it, they're always going to follow God. I don't care what kind of threat. No good bribing these people. They're going to follow God every time. It's no good tempting them towards sin. They're going to follow God every time. It's no good trying to provoke them to anger. They're going to follow God every time. There's no good even trying to get them to come towards sin. They're going to follow God every time. May that be said of us. They're going to follow God every time. If we want to destroy them, let's find a way where following God will lead to their destruction. That's a sure way to do it. They're determined to destroy Daniel, so they set this trap. Darius falls for it, probably thinking this is a way to unify the kingdom around himself. Though he has affection for Daniel, he didn't notice, apparently, that Daniel isn't there agreeing with this petition. And so he agrees, he signs it into law, and then we want to notice Daniel's hope in the face of this danger. Notice Daniel's hope. Verse 10, very important. When Daniel knew that the document had been signed, pause. What does he do? He went to his house where he had windows in his upper chamber open toward Jerusalem. He got down on his knees three times a day and prayed and gave thanks before his God as he had done previously. I mean, this has to be one of the most marvelous examples of a steadfast, confident, hope, following the Lord of steadfast love and faithfulness that there is in the Old Testament. When he knew that the den of lions would be the result of following God, he said, I will hope in the Lord. I will pray and make my petition. I do not fear this death. I will not give in to this temptation. My life is nothing if only I can be found faithful, is how Paul would put it, millennia later. I do not count my life of any value. Daniel would have said, well said, Paul. If only I can finish my course. Well said, Paul. That's how I would say it. Important to notice when he's praying towards Jerusalem, that's not just because, you know, he wants to see the sun in a particular way. That reflects a prayer that King Solomon made over the tabernacle. And he said, look, Lord, when your people sin against you and they're exiled from this land, Lord, even then, even in exile, when they pray towards your tabernacle, when they pray towards Jerusalem, Lord, would you please rescue? Would you hear their prayer? Would you bring them mercy and deliverance? And Daniel knows his Bible. So he just picks up that prayer of King Solomon and he acts on it. He sits down, he looks towards Jerusalem as a symbolic way of saying, Lord, that's where you've revealed yourself to your people. That's the promised land for our people historically. And Lord, I am praying towards your mercy and your deliverance for my people in exile and probably for myself in this situation. To pray towards Jerusalem would be to pray towards the covenant-keeping God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and David, who promised to be with his people. It's to hope that his mercy was not exhausted when they were sent into exile. Daniel's hope is fixed on the Lord. When the lions roar, where is our hope? When the lions roar, where is our hope? Daniel's hope is fixed on the Lord. He will follow God into the pit of lions. His hope is fixed on the Lord, the God of steadfast love, who chose his people and who gave them his grace and his presence and promised the opportunity to cry out for grace even after exile. Daniel says, that is my hope. That is my God. When the lions roar, my hope is fixed on the Lord. Now, brothers and sisters, all of us face the same kind of opportunity that Daniel faced. All of us do. All of us do. Now, not all of us will die. Probably none of us will die in a pit of lions. But all of us face the lions of this world determined to destroy us, to persecute and to tempt and to devour. And all of those smaller human lions are motivated finally by the great enemy that the New Testament says prowls around like a roaring lion seeking someone to devour. When Adam and Eve sinned, it says in Genesis, when God says what's going to happen, he says, look, what's going to happen is this great snake, this deceiver, there's going to be enmity between him and the seed of the woman, namely the line where God is going to give covenant promises to this descendants and descendants and descendants that will lead finally to Jesus. There's going to be an enmity. There's going to be a war. Because Satan hates God and he hates his people and he's determined to devour. And so this experience of physical lions and these lions called satraps and governors in Persia looking to destroy him, this is just the next example of the great enemy of God looking to destroy and devour God's people. We know this all the way through into the New Testament. Paul prays this way, and probably for him, literally, there was the danger of being eaten by lions. He says in 2 Timothy 4:17, but the Lord stood by me and strengthened me so that through me the message might be fully proclaimed and all the Gentiles might hear it. So I was rescued from the lion's mouth. And then Peter says, be sober-minded, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion seeking someone to devour. Resist him, firm in your faith, knowing that the same kinds of suffering are being experienced by your brotherhood throughout the world. And after you have suffered a little while, the God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, confirm, strengthen, and establish you. To him be the dominion forever and ever. Amen. What roaring lions are you hearing that are threatening you and seeking to drive you away from God? Maybe the roaring lions are at work, where the normal procedure is to get away with practices that lack integrity. And if you do not fall in line, you will not be promoted. Where is your hope? Where are you facing when those lions roar? Maybe you're in high school and the roaring lions are a commonality of immorality around you, such that your friends and your peers cannot understand why you would desire to be pure. It makes no sense, and you will be excluded from their fellowship if you do not comply. Where's your hope when those lions roar? Or maybe you are going to try to stand for the Lord in your neighborhood and share the gospel, and the roaring lions are basically the elimination of some ease of fellowship and connection and the just comfort level with the people around the neighborhood. That's those people. And that roar can tempt you to put your hope in connections and being associated with people and ease of relationship. Where is your hope when that lion roars? Where's your hope when the lion says it is easier to give in to sin than to resist and confess and live in transparency? Where's your hope when that lion roars? Where are you facing when that lion roars? The roar is loud. It's ugly. It's dangerous. And sometimes it's people determined to slander and destroy you because of your faith. That's possible. There might be people, there might be family members, there might be former friends that seek to slander and destroy you. That's going to happen sooner or later in this church and in other churches. It's happened to me in the past where people are determined to tear you to shreds like a pack of lions. The devil, Peter says, he prowls around like a roaring lion, and Peter would know. Jesus said to him, "Pray, Peter, watch with me so that you won't fall into temptation." I think that might have been on Peter's mind when he said that later. Trust me, the lion roars sometimes through the simple question of a young girl around a fire. And she says, "You're not one of Jesus' followers, are you?" And it's tempting to turn away and say, "No, I'm not." But if you remember Daniel and what he did, you're motivated. Hope. Hope in God. Turn, as it were, towards the place of his covenant promises, towards the place where he revealed himself, towards his assurance that he would be with you. Turn. Hope. Trust. No matter what it means, no matter what den of lions are roaring at you. Well, as the enemy's guest knew, were confident, they come, they find Daniel praying, they go back to the king. The king is distressed. One commentator I read this week made the point that even people in the world who are favorably disposed towards you are not a confident or helpful place of trust, because they are not God. Darius has been favorably disposed towards Daniel, even to the point of raising him over the whole kingdom. But when it really came down to it, he was not willing to sacrifice himself and his reputation to save Daniel. And so the point could be, look, if you're God's people, even if you happen to have a person in power that's favorably disposed towards you, don't put your trust in princes. Because in the end, the only person who can save and deliver finally is the Lord. Because even Darius, and all of his affection for Daniel apparently, is unwilling to overrule his own law. Now, he could have done what he did later and written a counter edict. That's what happened in the book of Esther. but he's unwilling to lose face, apparently. So off Daniel goes. The king commanded, verse 18. Down he goes. And the grotesqueness and finality of these words, a stone is placed over this pit and the king's signet reel is on it. You can just imagine Daniel could be thinking, we're of no promise that Daniel has he's going to be delivered. He might be thinking, this is it. This is my final, as an 80-year-old man, this is my final statement that I will follow God. I get to do what my three friends did and said, even if he doesn't rescue me, I will not worship your gods or bow down to the image. And I'm doing the same thing. And in some ways, if we benefit from church history, there may have even been a level of joy in Daniel's heart to say, Lord, if this is how I go out, it would be glorious. Brutal and painful, but glorious. Quick aside, we don't know exactly how old. Daniel's probably about 80 years old. He served for 70 years in exile. But I can just make a point to those of you that are seniors, whatever you want to define that age. There's a point to be made here that Daniel's faith does not wane with age. His body may be less strong and vigorous, but his faith is passionate. He goes right to his room. He opens the windows. He prays as he's always done. He declares, my hope is in the Lord. Brothers and sisters, older brothers and sisters, we need your vigorous expression of faith in this church. We need it. We need you to be like Daniel and reveal for us that age is no measure of the strength of faith towards God. Please continue to be the example you already are in this church. We need you to be that example. There's something about somebody who has seen God's faithfulness for decades saying, God is worthy of your hope. And it comes out different than it does for a person who's done it for a few years. Let me encourage you to follow in Daniel's footsteps and set an example of faith-filled hope to the end. So what happens? The roaring lions lead us to the second section. Let's read it together. Verse 19. Then at break of day, the king rose and went in haste to the den of lions. And as he came near to the den where Daniel was, he cried out in a tone of anguish. The king declared to Daniel, O Daniel, servant of the living God, has your God, whom you serve continually, been able to deliver you from the lions? Then Daniel said to the king, O king, live forever. What a moment. Imagine the entourage. Apparently the satraps are probably there as well, smirking. And then here comes this voice, probably muffled, out of this cave. And he says, O king, live forever. My God sent his angel and shut the lions' mouths, and they have not harmed me, because I was found blameless before him. And also before you, O king, I have done no harm. Then the king was exceedingly glad and commanded that Daniel be taken up out of the den. So Daniel was taken up out of the den, and no kind of harm was found on him because he had trusted in his God. And the king commanded, and those men who had maliciously accused Daniel were brought and cast into the den of lions, they, their children, and their wives. And before they reached the bottom of the den, the lions overpowered them and broke all their bones in pieces. Now, remember, God is not endorsing the killing of children. This is Persia. This is Darius's response, okay? So this is not like God saying he's recommending this. He's just pointing out, look, the very people who sought to destroy Daniel find themselves destroyed. Disaster overtakes, finally, those who would seek to destroy those that belong to the Lord in the end. But not an endorsement of this kind of activity governmentally or anything along those lines. Then King Darius wrote to all the peoples, nations, and languages that dwell in all the earth, peace be multiplied to you. I make my decree that in all my royal dominion, people are to tremble and fear before the God of Daniel, for he is the living God, enduring forever. His kingdom shall never be destroyed, and his dominion shall be to the end. He delivers and rescues. He works signs and wonders in heaven and on earth. He who has saved Daniel from the power of the lions. So this Daniel prospered during the reign of Darius and the reign of Cyrus the Persian. The roaring lions and the rescuing Lord. The rescuing Lord, point number two. Incredible drama. As I've said before, yes, the Bible is God's authoritative word, but the Bible is also a book. So we have to get into the literary process of it so that we feel the emotion of it. And if you notice, the writer of Daniel, he draws this out because he wants you to feel the drama. So this king can't sleep, the king of an empire. He just, apparently, it's a vision of him just staring. And no diversions. I don't want any food. Don't let me distract me. I'm so worried about Daniel. And the night passes, and we're left unknowing what's going on with Daniel. And then the king, in desperation, crying out, Daniel, has your God delivered you? And up comes the voice from the tomb. O king, live forever. My God sent his angel, and he shut the lions' mouths. And just to ensure that there's no modern skepticism or cynicism that creeps in, the writer points out, look, these weren't just full lions, okay? They weren't just sluggish or lethargic. They weren't not hungry. Darius hadn't like, hey, feed him an elephant and then send Daniel in. That isn't what happened, okay? Because the moment the enemies get tossed in, before they even hit the ground, these lions overpower. You get the sense that the lions are like, finally, finally. We've had to sleep with this guy all night long. I'm starving. I mean, that's the sense you get. They get thrown in, and instantly there's this roar and just devoured and this grotesque. I mean, just the scene would be grotesque, right? But it's supposed to be grotesque because it accents by contrast what just happened. The lions who had been Daniel's pillow at night become devouring, feasting animals when the enemies are thrown in. The only explanation is Daniel's. God shut the lions' mouths. The lions obeyed the voice of the real sovereign. They closed their mouths until God said, now you may open them. God rescues. And then, like it has so often in the book of Daniel, God puts in the mouth of a pagan king the theological lesson. Fear and tremble before the God of Daniel. You think you should fear before the lions, but apparently not. Apparently the lions take orders. Apparently you don't have to fear before the lions because God can shut the mouths of the lions. Apparently the lions aren't nearly as scary as someone who gives them orders. And the one who ultimately gives them orders is God. So tremble in fear before the lions? No, before God. God shut the mouths of the lions for Daniel. So, let me tell you what to do. All my empire, here's what I'm going to give you. Here's some instructions. You better fear the God of Daniel, because he can rescue even from lions. He rescues. He saves. He delivers. Daniel trusted in him, and Daniel emerges unscathed. And then Daniel prospers. Again, we see this same contrast. In the end, the one who trusts in the Lord, in the end, not in the meantime, not throughout the journey, but in the end, the one who trusts in the Lord is elevated and exalted, and the one who finally accuses and rejects and seeks to slaughter God's people, they are finally destroyed. Notice the kind of vertical contrast in the literature of this passage. Daniel is at the height of power. He descends down into the pit, and then he is raised and prospered and exalted. And there's sort of a picture there of the normal Christian faithful life. There's moments where you just plunged down into the pit of suffering and persecution, but in the end, you emerge. How do we apply this to ourselves? How do we apply Daniel's experience? Because we live after the coming of Jesus Christ. We don't live in exile in Babylon, though we do live in exile as well from our heavenly homeland. How do we apply this to ourselves? Well, I think sometimes the Lord rescues his people from persecution and suffering. Sometimes the Lord still shuts the lion's mouth, like he did with Paul for a while. Sometimes God works in miraculous ways and delivers from the attempts of the enemy to slaughter and destroy and hurt. He rescues miraculously. And so like Daniel, we can pray, Lord, when we face persecution or the temptation of the Lord, would you please deliver me? Would you rescue me miraculously like you did Daniel? For those that are facing physical persecution in other parts of the world, we can pray for them that God would stop and thwart the evildoers who would seek to do them harm. Because God does that. God does not always require his children to endure endlessly through suffering. Sometimes he raises them out of it and stops the evil. Sometimes God saves from persecution and suffering. And I think this is especially true and always true for the Christian when it comes to the enemy of our souls and his attempt to destroy our souls. Yes. Scripture says that God provides a way of escape. So the enemy that seeks to devour our faith through his lies, through his temptations, through his accusations, he is called the accuser of the brothers. The Lord rescues. So if you're a Christian and you sense the roaring lion, Satan himself, seeking to accuse you and lie to you and tempt you away from your God, our God still closes the mouth of the lion like he did for Daniel. And through his word, we can declare, we believe in Jesus Christ, we are claimed and cleansed and covered by him, and we hope in the same covenant God of Daniel, and we look to his covenant promises and his assurance of faithful, steadfast love, proven forever in the cross of Jesus Christ, and we say, this lion cannot finally destroy what I have in Jesus. I find myself in him, I turn my face towards him as Daniel did towards the New Testament tabernacle, and I say, in him I am secure, my soul is safe, and whatever this lion may attempt to do, finally I am in the hands of the Savior. And we pray, would you shut the lion's mouth? The whispers of temptation and the roars of accusation. We say, no, by the name of Jesus Christ, I claim the one who can close the mouth of the great lion. If you're a mom and you face the accusations of being insufficient or a failure, and that ultimately that is what defines you, you can turn to the one who claims you as his own and who has spoken to your accusers and saying, I have borne every sin in their place, and there is now no accusation that can stick to them because they are found in me. Or if you're a dad and you look back at failures and sins that you've committed and you feel yourself hearing the voice of accusation saying, there's no hope for you. You've failed again and again. You might as well be cast into forgetfulness before God and before your family and before your friends. You can say, no, I believe in a Redeemer. I have turned my face towards him, that covenant Redeemer who established a new covenant in his blood. And I declare, I am safe in him from the power of the lions. Sometimes he rescues us from persecution and suffering, and he always does that from the spiritual kind. But sometimes he rescues us through persecution and suffering. Through. For some, and I want to bring this to us because I think it is wise for us to prepare and to anticipate the possibility of this, and to pray for those for whom this is the case. Some, he rescues through persecution and suffering. For some, persecution and suffering is the doorway into closer fellowship with him. Either closer fellowship in the immediate of this earth, and ultimately closer fellowship by being ushered in to his kingdom where we see him face to face. Surely this was the case for every Christian martyr, for whom the lions were simply the gatekeepers into sinless and perfect fellowship with the Lord in heaven. Through suffering, they entered into the life where suffering would be no more, where pain would be no more. Their suffering was quickly over, and their joy was eternal. Listen to the words of the martyr Ignatius. He was a disciple of the Apostle John, who was taken captive in the first part of the second century, about 70 years or so after the death of Jesus. And he said this in writing to fellow Christians in anticipation of his own death. He said, "Allow me to become food for the wild beasts, through whose means it will be granted me to reach God. I am the wheat of God, and am ground by the teeth of the wild beasts, that I may be found the pure bread of Christ." That's our brother. And he had this confidence not only that God could rescue from the lions, but through the lions, ultimately to be ushered into the Lord. Now, how can he have that confidence? Well, we have that confidence because we, like Ignatius, our brother, had an even better story to remember than Daniel. Now, it's like Daniel's story, and if you were paying attention closely, you may have noticed the similarities. It's actually a lot like the story of Joseph. There's similarities here, because in God's Word in the Old Testament, there's patterns, there's pictures that anticipate how there was going to be an ultimately righteous Israelite that was going to ultimately walk in the path of his people as the ultimate expression and revelation of God's steadfast love. How does God finally deliver his people ultimately from the roar of the ultimate lion? How does God ultimately do that? Does he just do it temporarily, physically, from one suffering being minimized and from another person being delivered from this difficulty, just temporarily? No. There's an ultimate lion with an ultimate danger, and the Lord Jesus rescues us ultimately from that danger by walking in the path of his people. Let me tell you what I mean. Like Daniel, Jesus was driven and taken from a place of prayer into a place of death. His enemies also falsely accused him based on his relationship to God. He also was silent as he faced his accusers, facing his sentence. He also was presented before a human throne with a man who desired to release him, but was finally unwilling to risk his own reputation to do so. However, unlike Daniel, Jesus did not merely descend into a pit to experience protection. Jesus descended into the pit of death itself and experienced God's abandoning of him. So he was finally vindicated when he rose from the dead, but the pit he went into was much deeper and the fate he suffered much worse. God didn't rescue Jesus from suffering, but through the absolute worst kind of suffering. So we look back and we enjoy Daniel's example, but we have an even better one to look back to now. We look to Jesus, and like Daniel did, we turn our face to that new place of the new covenant on Calvary, and we say, "Oh, we know one who walked this road, but walked it deeper, who revealed God's saving, rescuing love by walking the very road his people before him had walked, but walking it deeper and walking it without the rescue in this life, only to be vindicated when he rose from the dead. God rescues us from a fate worse than Daniel's by coming himself to descend into that pit himself. God rescues us from a fate worse than Daniel's by coming to descend into that pit himself. So, when you read Daniel 6, it should bring your mind to someone greater than Daniel who is here. Daniel was a faithful man, a faithful Israelite, but there's an even better Israelite. And his story is even better. Daniel didn't save anybody by going into that pit. Jesus went into that pit and saved
all of his people. He went into that pit and rescued all of his people from the ultimate lion and the ultimate pit. Daniel came out and he himself was not harmed. Jesus came out and all of us will be unharmed. And his kingdom that went into the pit, his kingdom will know no end. And he delivers and rescues, and he works signs and wonders no greater than the coming of Jesus Christ to die and rise again and bring his people finally into a glorious kingdom that will know no end. No greater sign than that. Yes, I agree with you, Darius. I agree. He does work signs and wonders. But if you're impressed by Daniel, I got one better. Imagine if you could have seen Jesus Christ on the cross suffering for sinners and dying in their place. And imagine if you could have seen the Lord of glory being taken under darkness into a tomb. And then imagine if you could have heard the roar of heaven when he emerged from that tomb and declared, "Now there is no more harm for my people because I have delivered them from the lion's mouth and finally from the pit." Oh, imagine, Darius, if you could have seen that. I can do you one better. Let no roar of the lions shake your hope in our Savior. The Lion of Judah roars louder. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we are so grateful to you. Lord, your word says you're like a lamb that went to the slaughter before its shearers was silent. It says in the Psalms that the enemies of the righteous one were like a ravening and a roaring lion. And Lord, that's what you faced. Not because you had to, not because you were helpless, Lord, but because we were. You let yourself be made into that vulnerable victim in our place. You let yourself experience the devastation and ferocity of our judgment and the mockery of the enemy in our place. You let yourself be bound and broken and pierced in our place, Lord. You let yourself, the Lord of life, go into the grave in our place so that in you we could rise forever to life where no fear of death threatens us anymore. We thank you, Lord Jesus, and we rejoice in you, and we celebrate the freedom and confidence that we have. And like Daniel, we turn our face towards you. You are our hope. We thank you in Jesus' name.